Welcome back. If you're new here, my name's Dan. You're watching Just a Printer. Today, talk about some paper. So I've had a lot of people ask me to talk about paper, choosing paper for specific projects, and just talk more about paper. And the reality is there's a lot to learn about paper, and I've partially been pushing it off because I do not feel qualified to talk about paper. I know a little bit about paper, but I don't necessarily know a lot of the science behind paper, but you could really go into details about how it's manufactured and things like that, but I'm just going to keep it simple because that's just the way I am, and that's really what you need to know to make some good decisions on paper. As I said in a previous video too, this is kind of a lineup of my bread and butter papers, and I try and keep it to a minimum, and It's fairly easy to kind of funnel projects into one of these sheets. I love to buy paper that's cut to size when possible, but the main reason that I buy parent sheet sizes are so I can attain the correct grain direction. You know, this is a 120 pound cover, it's grain short. If I need it grain long, you can't buy it that way. You gotta make your own, so you have to buy a parent sheet and cut it down. What's a parent sheet? Let me show you. There's a parent sheet. That's a parent sheet. Here's 11.5 by 17.5. That's a parent sheet. I cut that in half to get short grain paper. So 25 by 38 and 17.5 by 11.5 are basically the two parent sheets that I buy the most of. There's a couple other ones in there if I want to get short grain 12 point C1S. What's C1S? Aha. C1S, coated one side, So that is often used for book covers or cards. The one side of the piece of paper is coated and the other side is not coated. I'll also make postcards out of C1S, and that's so you can easily write on the uncoated side, or if you're putting on inkjet addresses, or if you're running them through a postage meter, you need to have that as an uncoated side. So I often do postcards like that. Now with book covers, I do C1S as well, because the adhesive for the binding will be more aggressive on an uncoated sheet than a coated sheet. Now you can bind a book cover with a 100-pound gloss cover, coated both sides, and it will work, but it just not quite as good. So C1S comes in several different points, which is a measure of how heavy that sheet is. It's the caliper of the paper. And you can get it in 10 point, 8 point, 12 point, 14, 16. I typically just keep 12 point C1S and 14 point C2S, coated two sides, here for the different jobs, and that works out well for pretty much everything I do. I just so happen to be printing cards on C1S. So this is a folded card. It's coated on the one side. It's not a very lustrous coating, but it's enough to certainly look different than the uncoated side. And then the inside is uncoated, so you can easily write on there with a pen or a pencil. So I'm not going to go too deep into the different weights of paper, just because it's been 13 years since I've been in college and took my paper classes, and you know, you can get really confused going down that road of the differences between board and tag, index, cover, bond, offset, my goodness. And then the different weights of all those and how they do not coincide with each other, such as your 24 pound paper that you get for your copier is actually 60 pound offset. Boy, if I had a nickel for every time I had to explain that to a customer. So I'm just gonna try and keep it simple. Like this Soper set, I've been using for several years now. Before that, we used Xerox brand. And that actually we purchased as a 24 pound paper. And then we also used Accent Opaque for a long time. That's a great sheet. And I kind of settled into Soperset. And it works real nice. So 60-pound uncoated is most of what I have, because I do a lot of books that are bound, either stitched or perfect bound. And uncoated paper is kind of where it's at with that. It's kind of a standard for a perfect bound book. So that's probably 80% of the paper that I buy is a 60-pound text weight. All right, enough talking. I gotta get some printing done, but then I'll be back. Said earlier, I like to try and funnel all of my customers into the paper that I keep in stock. And that's not because I'm being mean, but it's because back in the day, I would try and order exactly what people wanted and custom order paper. And that just gets to a lot of inventory that ends up becoming stale and not being used. So you either A, need to charge the customer for all the paper you buy, even if you don't use it, for their job, or B, you end up just sitting on it for months or years. There's some paper here that's been here for years, and it's just a reminder not to do that again. But most people are okay with funneling into a particular paper, and the reality is if you try and help everybody, you're gonna run out of time, and you're not gonna be profitable. That's why I keep just a small amount of paper in stock, and most people are okay with that. There's a good example of some carbonless I bought years ago, and there it sits. This was a three-part. It had a manila back, and then a yellow inside and white on top. And that's manila coated front, so the coating is on the front. This is CFB, coated front back, and CB, coated back. So combined, when you stack that up to the back, the middle, and the top, those are the sheets that get glued together with your fan apart adhesive. So that's what the CF, CB, and CFB stand for. And I should also mention that you can get carbonless in pre-collated, which is this stuff that I buy down here, meaning that it's in order, yellow, white, yellow, white, yellow, white, or uncollated, when it's separate, and then you have to collate it. Since then, I only keep three types of carbonless. I get 11 by 17 two-part, 11 by 17 three-part, and I have just a little bit of four-part here. If there's some sort of a specialty thing, either outsource it or B, just say no. So the cover of this booklet is gonna be 80-pound gloss. And here's a good example of why I keep two of those in stock. So I buy that in the cut sheet size 13 by 19. All of these I buy at 13-19, which is the largest sheet size for my press. I used to keep in stock smaller sheet sizes. It's just easier to keep one size. Anyways, this is grain short. It's 19 by 13. The second number is always the grain direction. So I want to do a two-up booklet on here. Now I could do it on here and score it, but you get a better quality product if the grain is parallel to the spine. So I really want a 13-19 80-pound gloss cover, grain direction in the 19-inch side. So I buy that in a parent sheet size and cut it down to 12-18 right here. But that's just because I have a handful of customers and a handful of jobs that need a grain long sheet. So I don't mind buying that and sitting on it for sometimes a month or two until I get a job. But I use it up. So let's load this up and print the covers. All right, these are printing. Now you could stitch those without scoring it, just because the grain direction is in the correct way direction there. However, I'm going to score it anyways. You just get a nicer product if you score it. Another type of paper that I do keep in stock, a small amount of it, is pressure sensitive, aka label stock, which is paper that has it adhesive and a backing, which is a sticker. So I keep a few sizes in stock because I have a handful of customers that order regularly on a specific size, but I try not to keep a whole lot of labels in stock. Pretty much everything is 11 by 17 or an 8.5 by 11. I mostly will turn away label work unless it's going to be a large amount, just because it's not worth it to order, you know, 50 or 100 die cut sheets and print them. You end up having to charge your customer a decent amount, and then I feel like I'm taking advantage of them. So, you know, I guess I'll consider envelopes paper as well, and this is my shelf of envelopes. Again, not an extensive inventory, but several standard sizes that will suit the needs of my customers. You know, I've got number 10 in window and security and regular, and then down to number 9s, 6 3/4, A6s, A2s, and just a few A7s. So that basically will take care of any envelope request I have. And if I don't have it here, I just tell my customer to go online to like envelopes.com or something and then buy either a specialty envelope or the different colors of envelopes. Again, unless they're going to be ordering thousands of envelopes, in which case it makes sense for me to order it and do the job. And also, those are all white. I keep it simple, kind of like my coils. These are all black. It's just one color. Who's that? Henry Ford? You can order any color as long as it's black. So back in the day, we had a lot more color sheets of paper. We had yellow, blue, you know, many different colors. And over the years, as color printing became more economical, most people just went to color printing on a white sheet of paper. That's why pretty much everything I keep in stock is white. The second most popular sheet that I stock is natural or a cream. So I stock some Cougar natural cover stock, and then either Accent Opaque warm white, Spring Hill cream, or a Cougar text weight of 60 pound text. And that's if somebody wants a book with the off-white paper inside, book covers, cards. There's a handful of jobs that I do just on a natural sheet. My other text weight and cover weight is another kind of specialty thing. So I usually buy it and use it for a job, and then I have some left over. A lot of this stuff will end up being used as slip sheets just to get rid of it. You know what? I have a question. Do any other Xerox people, I just remembered, if you bought Bright Q paper on Xerox Nuveras, the toner would not stick. It was just Bright Q. And that was wild to me. I would really like to know why that doesn't happen. There is something in the paper that would not allow the toner to adhere correctly to a Bright Q sheet of paper. I want to know if people are still, does that still exist? Let me know. Another type of paper that I do keep in stock is linen. Again, not a whole lot of linen gets printed around here, but from time to time we do a little bit of linen, so I have just a few cases of paper here with some cover weight and text weight. That is a real nice way to really make something artistic pop, and it looks really nice most of the time. Sometimes you'll get a void in the valleys of the paper because a linen has hills and valleys, and you kind of have to mess with your settings a little bit. Sometimes it looks great, sometimes it does not. One thing you do have to remember with a linen sheet is one side is more coarse than the other side. It's more of an aggressive hill and valley, and the other side is a little smoother. You can keep that in consideration when you're printing it. Certainly if it's a single-sided, keep your smoother side up that you're printing on, and you'll get better results. Here's a fun type of paper too, some Gill Clear. It is a translucent sheet of paper that I had gotten for one job back in the day, and I have just a little bit left, but it's neat because you get a nice effect if you put this into a book. You can see through it when it's down, but then when you pick it up, it becomes opaque. So that's a neat feature to make a project, pop and step apart from other papers. You can do some really cool stuff with this. Again, that's 29-pound Gill Clear. So if gloss is too shiny and uncoated is too uncoated, you can get papers in between as well. And you can actually get papers glossier than gloss, like a chrome coat if you wanted to. Recently, within the past 10 years or so, Accent Opaque has come out with a smooth text, and that's a really nice sheet. I do have this for a few jobs that I do. It's just an uncoated sheet that is calendared a little bit more so that it's very smooth, and then your image just looks more consistent when you print on that. I should probably talk about calendaring, and that is a process that happens after the paper is made into a sheet. The paper goes into calendar rolls, and they're polished rolls, and heat and pressure presses and basically buffs that paper to create a smoother sheet. And the more you do that, the more gloss you get. I keep this simple because you could also get a dull sheet, which is right in between uncoated and coated, which is very similar to the super smooth. You can get matte. There's several different finishes you can go after, but I just try and keep it simple. It's better for everybody, I think, anyways. I just saw this paper, which I didn't really talk about. This is called a parchment paper, and you can get this in several different colors. This one's green. You can get like a gold. Astro Parch makes this, but boy, I think they discontinued. They're not even making this paper anymore. It's kind of an old-timey look. I don't use it a whole lot, and I don't keep it in stock anymore. This is just a couple sheets left that I'm just going to use as slip sheets. If you're curious, this is all different types of paper. Every single one of these. And although some of these are discontinued, that's all the different types of paper that you can buy from my distributor. But there's plenty others available too, and they change. Every year, mills will change what they got. So different colors, different weights. Oh yeah, metallic papers. I even have some of these in stock that are left over. You can get envelopes and paper that has like a metallic glitter to it. Here's more of the translucent. This is a different brand. You can actually get translucent envelopes and papers. So I'm actually fairly lucky here with just toner-based digital presses because I don't take into consideration a lot the different types of paper and how that affects how it looks when I print. And what I mean is, if you're doing offset printing, if you print on an uncoated sheet, it looks really dull and muted. But if you print on a gloss sheet, it has a lot of snap and it really pops. And that's just because of the ink. And offset, your ink soaks into your paper. Depending on what type of ink you're using, it's going to cure by absorbing in or evaporating, off-gassing. And that changes the type of papers that you want to use. For me, I buy offset or digital paper, and I run it all on my presses without any problem. If you're running an inkjet printer, you might consider paper that is made just for inkjet printing. It has a coating so that the ink doesn't soak in and look bad. So there is cellulose and a lot of other stuff. Well, maybe not a lot, but there's other things in paper too. And I forget a lot of what those are. I do know that there is clay in coated paper, and that makes the shiny luster. So if you take a coated piece of paper, it's tough to burn, and if you can get it to burn, there's a lot of ash left over, and that's clay and other fillers that are used to create that coated sheet. Other things you might want to take into consideration when you're choosing paper for a certain job is what you're going to be using that for. So if you're going to be printing postcards, you're going to want a certain amount of body to that so it makes its way through the postal system. If you're going to be mailing a magazine or even letters, put it into an envelope, you might want to use a lighter paper to save on postage costs. You also need to take into consideration finishing steps afterwards. Perforating and folding, you always want your grain direction to be parallel to your fold. If you're going to be coil binding a book and it has 100 pound text, it's going to take you longer to punch that than it is to punch a book that's made out of 60 pound text. And that's just because of the caliper is going to be different. So you need to make sure you think about those things when you figure out costs. Okay, so here is a recent paper order that I have. 14 point C2S up top here, and I typically buy 12 point C1S as a 19 by 13 sheet, but they're sold out. And nothing else comparable would work, so I had to buy a folio sheet, which is right down here. This is a 19 by 25. So 19 by 25, the grain direction is going to be in the 25 inch. So I can easily cut these down to be 12 and a half by 19. So I can order larger sheets and cut them down to the size that I want. It's kind of a bummer because I have to cut it down and it's not just ready to print. But on the bright side, I get to use a new cutter. One last thing I'd like to say about paper is how great it is, and actually how green it is. I know some people get a little anxious to see large amounts of paper and thinking about all the trees that are cut down to create that paper. But the reality is paper is a crop. It's just like corn or soybeans or wheat or carrots or anything else that you eat. It's grown, it's harvested, and it's replanted. You know, sustainable forestry companies are going to be planting trees faster than they're cutting them down. It just takes a lot longer for that crop to mature till it's cut down and made into paper. By all means, don't waste paper. You can still reduce and reuse and recycle, but it's not that bad. That's part of the reason that I like that I heat this building with firewood, just because it's renewable. You know, it's not ever gonna completely get used up. Trees are growing all the time and are always gonna be there for paper or heating your house. So I know it's probably a debatable subject, but that's just my two cents on it. I guess that's it for today. If I missed something, please put it down below. If I said something incorrect, let me know, because I'm always learning. I'm thanking you guys for helping me out too. So thanks for watching. We'll catch you next time.